So, how about that DuckTales reboot, huh? Yeah, I haven't really been keeping up with it myself, because there's only so much time in the day and I have to keep making videos for you all so YouTube won't shove me down off the recommended vids list. However, from the few episodes I have watched, I can say that this is how you do a reboot right, as so far, it's kept the spirit of the original alive, while at the same time updating it to fit in more with what we expect from a more modern, well-made piece of animation. But that got me thinking. Like most people when I was growing up during the 90s, the original DuckTales was a staple of my Saturday mornings and weekday afternoons. But I haven't watched it in years, and yet still had enough nostalgia to worry about whether or not the reboot would be any good, or if it would hold my attention the way the original did, despite no longer being in the primary demographic that the new show is aiming for. So I decided to marathon the original show and see if my nostalgic feelings kept me from seeing the show in too negative of a light. I'm happy to say that while it doesn't hold the same sort of mystique as it did when I was growing up, the show is still very fun to watch and still manages to make me smile. Before we get into the review proper, I do think it's important to set down just how important this cartoon actually is. Disney was the first company to take a big risk on television animation. Before Disney put out high-cost, high-risk products like DuckTales and The Adventures of the Gummy Bears, television animation was mostly relegated to the limited animation that was popularized with studios like Hanna-Barbera. And unless you were an unbelievably super popular and super cheap hit like Scooby-Doo, reruns weren't really a thing. Disney proved that high-budget animation made for the express purpose of syndication could be profitable, and DuckTales was a major success because of that, staying on the air for damn near a decade after it premiered. Needless to say, the theme song helped with that. Let's get this out of the way now, folks. Yes, this is a damn catchy theme song, and it is one of the biggest earworms you can find in animation. And whenever I hear the thing, I can't help but hum along even after the show is over. What exactly is the show about, though? Well, good old Donald Duck has been called out to active service in the Navy, and as such has to leave Huey, Dewey, and Louie with their great uncle Scrooge, the richest duck in the world. After an initial adventure involving the Beagle Boys and finding an artifact of immense wealth hidden deep within the jungle, Scrooge and the nephews, along with a huge host of other characters including unlucky pilot Launchpad McQuack, eccentric inventor Gyro, tag-along Webby, prim and proper housekeeper Mrs. Beakley, and accountant-turned-superhero Fenton Crackshell, aka Gizmo Duck, would go on adventures of the week, usually either detailing Scrooge's attempts to gain a highly valuable hidden or lost treasure, or the gang defending Scrooge's vast wealth, primarily his money bin, from a massive gallery of villains like Flintheart Glomgold, the Beagle Family, Magica Dispel, Murloc the Magician, Dijon the Thief, and a huge host of others, some after his wealth for pure greed and others for ulterior, sometimes even more sinister, motives. This is very much an adventure of the week show, and aside from the first five episodes, which make up their own story arc, and were originally aired as a TV pilot movie, there weren't a whole lot of multi-part stories, maybe around one or two sprinkled throughout the show, but every episode was usually its own self-contained story, and the focus was put almost completely on the adventure aspect. Not every episode was your typical treasure hunt or beat the baddie affair, though. There were plenty of examples of silly, small slice-of-life problems suddenly ballooning out of hand and causing a massive catastrophe, such as a coin replicator causing such a massive overflow of silver dollar coins that the entire economy of Duckburg ends up collapsing, or the nephews trying to trick Scrooge into handing over their allowance early by tricking him into thinking it's actually a day later in the week than it actually is, which eventually causes the entire world to skip a day. This series even had a particularly hilarious time travel episode, which I usually hate, where Gyro goes back in time specifically because he wants to experience life in the Middle Ages firsthand, but everyone he meets in that time period doesn't want to talk about their time, they want to talk about his. But really, anything was fair game for the show. Science and technology frequently intermingled with the mystical and the magical, and thanks to Scrooge's status as a gajillionaire, they could literally have the story take place anywhere in the world that they wanted to, or off of the world if they felt like it. Nothing was off limits, and because this was made very clear very early on in the show's runtime, nothing felt out of place either. spending the night in a haunted Scottish castle, breaking out of an Alcatraz stand-in, going back in time to help Homer write the Odyssey? For Scrooge and the gang, it's all Tuesday. Now, of course, there always being something new in every episode could easily backfire in the series if it wasn't done well. I'm reminded of the Super Mario Super Show, where Mario and company would find themselves in a different land every episode, from Carland to Rapland to Jungleland to Spaceland and so forth, without any context whatsoever. They were just there. And while the show could definitely boast variety, the writing wasn't nearly as tight or consistent as DuckTales. I will thoroughly admit, though, to finding the show actually fun to watch, even if it is objectively poor in execution. But with DuckTales, the writing had a certain level of consistency to it that grounded us in that world. While we might be going on some very fun and interesting adventures, there are certain rules that help us know how the world works, and those rules generally don't change as the series goes on. For example, in almost every episode, we start with establishing moments in Duckburg, usually in Scrooge's mansion, giving us a sense of familiarity and safety, grounding us in the world, before taking us off on a bit of globetrotting. Of course, you can't have wild adventures without a group of intrepid adventurers, and that's what you definitely get with DuckTales. As I pointed out above, the show had an impressively large cast of primary and secondary recurring heroes and villains, and even the primary cast that shows up in almost every episode is still quite large, consisting of six characters, those being Scrooge, Launchpad, the Nephews, and Webby. But thankfully, all of them are given distinct, unique personalities with very likable quirks, flaws, and positive traits. Which is very necessary considering that there isn't much resembling character development in this series. The show doesn't really try to teach morals or lessons, all the better for it, I think. But even if it did, the lessons probably wouldn't sink in given the show's episodic nature and its focus being more on the story it's currently telling rather than the characters driving that story. And that's not a bad thing in this case. I've heard the characters of DuckTales being described as flat before, and for some of them, yes, that is a fair assumption to make, meaning that their characters are very one-dimensional, and there's not a whole lot to them. Most of the villains could certainly qualify for that. But for the primary cast, I think they're more rounded than that. Are they static characters? Absolutely, no one changes or grows at all throughout the course of the show. The one exception might be Scrooge, but even then, his development is mostly limited to the first five episodes as he learns to loosen his fist from his wads of cash and open up a bit more to his family and friends. But you still see that minor development all throughout the course of the show, as he consistently tries to balance his love of money and adventure with still being a parental figure to his nephews. What about Launchpad, the clumsy, wisecracking pilot who seems to even look up to Scrooge a little bit as well, not just as an employee, but also as a friend? He was so popular and such a fun character that he'd make the jump to another Disney Afternoon staple when the 90s rolled around, but that's a topic for a review later down the line. And yes, other characters are much less nuanced, can't deny that. Huey, Dewey, and Louie are especially guilty of this, mostly because they're just clones of one another, something that was true for the original theatrical shorts they starred in as well. If you merged the three of them together, you wouldn't really notice the absence of the other two. Webby is probably the biggest point of contention, as she is basically there just to give a young girl to the cast. While she does get her fair share of focus episodes, where she's integral to the adventure, and her naivete or girlishness, the 80s were a much different time, was shown to be useful when it came to animals or extraterrestrials. Yeah, the show was weird enough that that statement actually made sense in context. It should be noted the show looks fantastic, which was one of the primary points when it was made to show high-quality animation can be done for television and still have it be profitable. Like I said before, when DuckTales came out, limited animation was still the rule rather than the exception, and thanks to DuckTales performing as well as it did and looking as good as it did, it ushered in a lot of fine-looking, well-crafted shows for several years before Flash became a standard in TV animation and everything got crappy again for a little while, but then it got all better again, kinda. The animation is very fluid, all of the characters have very recognizable designs and silhouettes, and they display an amazing range of emotions as the series goes on, from surprise, to joy, to sadness, to disappointment, to anger, and it all looks wonderful. while still remaining true to the design set by both the original theatrical shorts, as well as taking some inspiration from the comics that really cemented Scrooge's character well before DuckTales became a thing. Incidentally, if you ever have a chance to read The Life and Times of Scrooge McDuck by Don Rosa, you definitely should. It's really good, even after all these years. Even the backgrounds are instantly recognizable. Duckburg itself, and of course Scrooge's money bin, isn't something you could easily mistake for something else. And while Scrooge and his family go out to other exotic locations all over the place, they all look amazing, and look just as wild and varied as the adventures we're taking on. Dense jungles, deep caves, different planets, different time periods, even the sky itself is made into an interesting location in the show. Not to say it's absolutely perfect, there are still occasional hiccups and flubs here and there. This is still cel animation after all, and as meticulous and polished as Disney can be at times, there are still one or two little things that fly under the radar. And while they are very few and far between, when an animation hiccup does show up, like the nephew suddenly switching colors for example, they can be very noticeable when you're actually sitting down to watch the episode. The look of the show is only bolstered by a fantastic voice cast. While David Tennant does a fantastic job as Scrooge in the reboot, I have a very hard time picturing anyone playing Scrooge besides Alan Young, may he rest in peace. And of course, recurring villainess Magica Dispel is played by the legendary June Foray. How legendary is she? This woman did the voices for most of the original Looney Tunes female characters, including Granny, Witch Hazel, and Bugs's many incidental love interests. Even if her voice here is basically the exact same one she used for Natasha back in Rocky and Bullwinkle. Oh yes, the woman played many classic cartoon gals. Requiescat in pace. Doing research for this, I was also pretty amazed by how many of the voice actors actually pulled double duty for many of the characters. For example, did you know that Russi Taylor not only played all three nephews, but also Webby? Yes, when all four of these characters are together, they're essentially talking to themselves. Or what about Hal Smith? He plays not only recurring inventor Gyro, but also plays recurring antagonist of the series Flintheart Glomgold. And they all sound fantastic, and very different from one another. A personal favorite of mine would definitely be Terry McGovern as Launchpad, though. There's just something about his always cheerful and upbeat yet somehow dopey voice that puts a smile on my face. It's just so positive. And as great and fantastical as all of this is, and as enjoyable as the stories are, it is important to keep in mind that this isn't complex art. You aren't going to find any deep meaning in this show, which can make it seem a little simplistic to someone who didn't grow up with it, especially when you're comparing it to the recent reboot. Not exactly a fair comparison, but this is the internet. Fair isn't in most people's vocabulary here. And that doesn't mean that the show is bad, it just means you're not going to see an analysis community crop up around it. Thank God for that. For my money, I think the show still holds up really well, even barring my nostalgia. The sense of adventure in this show is great, the characters are incredibly likable and recognizable, and even more importantly, the show feels timeless. It still feels just as fun to watch now as it did back then when I was growing up, to the point that I was totally unaware it was a series from the 80s. It seemed to fit right in just fine alongside everything else that was contemporary at the time. If you have any sort of love for the rebooted series, if you grew up with the old one, or if you haven't seen either and just want to experience some good and at this point classic Disney animation, this series is worth your time. The entire series is available on DVD for a very reasonable price. You can score all 65 episodes for under $30 or so. If you are a fan of the original series, I am interested in hearing if it's still held up for you as well. Let me know in the comments below. And thanks again for watching, and I'll see you all next time.